Hey everybody, welcome to Reading the Bible to Cats. I am excited to do this video and thank you to the new subscribers that we have. I'm always so surprised when new people come on board and I don't know, I'm just always surprised. It's like, do you really want it? Hear me rambling and reading the Bible and filming terribly. But I guess you do, and I'm just honored. But anyway, here are the kitties sleeping on each other. And we will be reading Joshua 17. But before we do, this will be an unusual video because the kitties, as I've mentioned before, but probably should mention again, the kitties aren't my real children. They definitely have a bio mom, but then they have a mom who adopted them, and that mom is my best friend. And I've been long-term cat sitting for her for like a year because she's had to travel, and but the kitties have known me since they were adopted, so I love them like they're my own. But anyway, their mom has sent them a gift, and so we're going to, but she told me that it had to be charged, but I said that we would unbox it. And if I can get the camera set, I think I have to move the camera. Okay, hold on 1 second, let me get the camera kind of situated, and then I'm going to bring the box over and we're going to open it for the kitties and they're going to look at it. Hold on, just look at the cute kitties for a minute while I get the box. Okay, I'm going to just kind of, okay kitties, let me let them sniff the box. This might be a longer video, but okay. Look. You want to sniff it? Yeah, he's interested. Guster's interested. Henry, would you like to sniff the box? Would you like to sniff it? Do you want to sniff it? Okay, Guster, are you sniffing too? Okay. So we've done the box sniffing. Okay, so let's open it. See, this is for you from your mommy. Oh gosh, I guess I need a scissors. I guess I didn't plan this too well. I'm now wrestling with the box. Oh, hold on. This is kind of awkward. Hey kitties, look! Look! Oh my gosh, kitties. Want to sniff it? Here, we'll take it out. It's a dancing fish! Oh my gosh. Okay, let's let them sniff it. Want to sniff the box again? Okay. Are you sniffing it well? Okay, a lot of sniffing. Okay, he sniffed enough. Would you like to sniff it? Okay. Okay, he sniffed enough. Now let's open it. Oh, it's so cute. My neighbor, her cat, Jambu, has this and he absolutely loves it. This fish. Oh, hold on. I guess I should have. I need a scissor. Oh, I got it. Okay, they're going to sniff this and then we will charge it and then, play with it later. Oh, I guess there's like, I think you put catnip in it. Oh, okay, hold on. We'll give them a few things to sniff. Okay, here. Oh, no, we lost one. Don't you? Guster! Well, here, let's let Henry sniff it. Would you like to sniff? You think you're gonna like that? Get to know it. Okay. Like, oh, Henry's actually, I mean, Guster's going to the, hold on, to the box and exploring that, the wrapping. And that's not actually the toy, but okay. So he's exploring it. Henry, is it, does it meet your standards? I know it's not bug, but oh, he's already playing with it. And it's not even charged. Oh, he likes it. It's a winner. It's a winner! He likes it. Oh, and then this goes in it. I guess it's catnip. You want to sniff it? Yeah. Would you like to sniff that? Okay. It's a winner! So yeah, we have to charge it, but okay, I'll let him rest on it and get to know it. Get to know the fish. Thank you, Petra. That's their mommy's name, Petra. Okay, well, let me get the camera situated. I can't. Okay, well, now let's go to the Bible. Yeah, let's go to the Bible. Joshua 17? Is that right? Do you like it, Henry? Is it exciting? You're cradling the fish. It must be good. Okay, Joshua 17. Yeah, we're on Joshua 17. So, next video, I'll have this charged and we can watch them play with it. The fish. Henry, could fish take over bug? Do you think fish will, will vie for the top spot in your toy? In your toy affection? Guster is exploring the packaging. Okay, well, let's read Joshua 17. I'm excited to charge the fish. Well, I guess he really likes it. He's resting on it. Wow. Are you gonna kick it? Are you gonna kick it? Okay, well. All right. Well, let's read Joshua 17. Okay. This was the allotment. Sorry, everybody. This was the allotment for the tribe of Manasseh as Joseph's firstborn, that is for Machir. Manasseh's firstborn. Machir was the ancestor of the Gileadites who had received Gilead and Bashan because the Machirites were great soldiers. So this allotment was for the rest of the people of Manasseh. The clans of Abiezer, Helek, Asriel, Shechem, Hepher, and Shemida. These are the other male descendants of Manasseh's son of Joseph by their clans. Now Zelophehad, son of Hepher, the son of Gilead, the son of Machir, the son of Manasseh, had no sons, but only daughters, whose names were Mahla, Noah, Hogla, Milcah, and Tirzah. They went to Eleazar the priest, Joshua son of Nun, and the leaders, and said, "The Lord commanded Moses to give us an inheritance among our relatives." So Joshua gave them an inheritance along with the brothers of their father, according to the Lord's command. Manasseh's share consisted of 10 tracts of land besides Gilead and Bashan, east of the Jordan, because the daughters of the tribe of Manasseh received an inheritance among the sons. The land of Gilead belonged to the rest of the descendants of Manasseh. The territory of Manasseh extended from Asher to Michmethath, east of Shechem. The boundary ran southward from there to include the people living at Entapua. Manasseh had the land of Tapua, but Tapua itself on the boundary of Manasseh belonged to the Ephraimites. Then the boundary continued south to the Cana Ravine. There were towns belonging to Ephraim lying among the towns of Manasseh, but the boundary of Manasseh was the northern side of the ravine and ended at the Mediterranean Sea. On the south, the land belonged to Ephraim, on the north to Manasseh. The territory of Manasseh reached the Mediterranean Sea and bordered Asher on the north and Issachar on the east. Within Issachar and Asher, Manasseh also had Bethshan, Iblim, and the people of Dor, Endor, Tanakh, and Megiddo, together with their surrounding settlements. The third in the list is Naphoth. Yet the Manassites were not able to occupy these towns, for the Canaanites were determined to live in that region. However, when the Israelites grew stronger, they subjected the Canaanites to forced labor, but did not drive them out completely. The people of Joseph said to Joshua, "Why have you given us only one allotment and one portion for an inheritance? We are a numerous people, and the Lord has blessed us abundantly." "If you are so numerous," Joshua answered, "and if the hill country of Ephraim is too small for you, go up into the forest and clear land for yourselves there in the land of the Perizzites and Rephaites." The people of Joseph replied, "The hill country is not enough for us, and all the Canaanites who live in the plain have chariots fitted with iron. But those in Bethshan and its settlements and those in the valley of Jezreel, both those in Bethshan and its settlements and those in the valley of Jezreel." But Joshua said to the tribes of Joseph, to Ephraim and Manasseh, "You are numerous and very powerful. You will have not only one allotment, but the forested hill country as well. Clear it and its farthest limits and will be yours. Though the Canaanites have chariots fitted with iron, and though they are strong, you can drive them out." Okay, everybody, that's the end of Joshua 17, which is interesting. I guess I can read the study note about verse 15, where it says, "Go up into the forest and clear land." And this is from the NIV First Century Study Bible. "There is archaeological evidence of the deforestation of Israel, particularly in the hill country, and the subsequent building of terraces to retain the topsoil for agriculture. Though difficult to date precisely, many of these terraces are from the early Iron Age, 1200 to 1000 BC, which seems to support this verse." And then about verse 16 regarding chariots. "This verse reveals the technological advantage that the Canaanites had over the Israelites. The chariot was a fierce weapon on open, flat terrain." Oh, okay. I can show you a picture in here too. Yeah, but that means I'll have to disrupt Henry with his fish. Okay, hold on. I'm going to show you this picture. Assyrian king Ashurbanipal using his chariot in a lion hunt. Oh no, a lion hunt! Henry, cover your ears. I don't want to hear about a lion hunt. Anyway, let's see if I can show you. Oh. There's the picture of the Assyrian king, King Ashurbanipal, using his chariot in a lion hunt. Aw, poor lion. Okay. Well, it's interesting about the daughters. I'm glad that they spoke up and were like, "Hey, the Lord gave us territory." And then one of the daughters' names, where were the daughters? I'm looking. Oh, yeah, their names were Mala, Noah, Ogla, which is an unfortunate name, I'm afraid. Even though back then it may have been a nice name, but I don't think anybody wants the name Hog Law. Even though the law is at the end, I don't think it would make it better. Hog Law. Then there's Milka and Tirza. Tirza, I've heard that name, but Hogla. That's comparable to being named like Pig, Pigla. Anyway, random. Rando. What do I want to say about this? Yeah. No, it's interesting how they didn't drive out the Canaanites, you know. Yeah. Don't know if I have anything else to say about it. It's just the inheritance, you know, how things were split up among the tribes. It's an interesting process, actually. Not like, you know, God says, okay, I'm giving you this promised land, it's yours. You know, it seems like there's just a lot of work entailed in you know, receiving the promised land. And, you know, even though it was theirs, they really had to take action. So it's like that tension between faith and action. You know what I mean? Like, you, in my mind, like, for instance, if I think about what I want from the Lord, which is not necessarily land, but more like spiritual land, like the fruit of his spirit, love. I want more love. I want more joy. I want more peace. I want more of that promised land. But I guess there's a tension between, well, yes, that's my inheritance, but then there's action that needs to be taken. And I think that action is, you know, related to abiding in the Lord, abiding in him and actually trusting him and having faith. That, like, the faith part. Anyway, that's my deep thought for the moment. But oh no, Kitty fell asleep. Hey, look, who's this? Who is this? Are you interested? Look, is it going to take the place of Bug? Are you gonna like this once I charge it and put the catnip in it? Are you gonna like it? I think he will like it. I think he's sleepy right now. But thank you, Petra. I know you love your babies. They love you too. And by the way, you know when Petra, I know you don't watch these videos, but maybe you'll watch this one. But when Petra gets settled, we'll, you know, and then Guster and Henry go back to her. We'll still figure out a way to make the videos, and then, you know, because I'll be seeing them a whole lot. But then I'll need kitties in my own home because I'll be bereft of kitties and that'll be very lonely. Anyway, I guess I won't use my baby voice anymore. Let's say a prayer. Lord, thank you for your word, and I pray that it's so actually foreign to me. I don't know. It is. It's like if I get an inheritance, I just want it. I don't want to have to like fight for it. It's faith is a hard thing, actually. But I ask that you, I don't know, illumine your word through the Holy Spirit and gift me with wisdom. And I pray that everybody who listens would somehow be inspired. We know that your word doesn't return void, so just let your word go forth and teach us through your Holy Spirit. I lift up my country and the US, and I pray for peace. I pray that instead of division, there would be a coming together. And instead of violence, I pray that people would love one another, especially people who claim to know you. I pray that, especially in the political realm, that people wouldn't demonize other people, but that we would love our neighbors as ourselves, that we would love our enemies, that we would seek your face and humble ourselves before you. Pray for revival. I pray for also for the peace of Israel, for the peace of Jerusalem, and for the hostages, the poor hostages. Please draw near to them and free them. And just all the war-torn countries and the animals that are affected too because of wars across the world. We pray for you, Jesus, to return. And pray for for peace. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, everybody. Look, he loves the fish. So next I'll charge it. 'Cause I guess when you charge it, I guess when they touch the fish, it'll flop around. And I wonder if Henry's just going to use it as like a pillow or if he's actually going to be into playing with it. I don't know. It really kind of looks like a real fish, though. It's cute. All right, everybody. Bye.